why is it not the Supreme Court's job to legislate?
Okay. Well, with all due respect to my judicial colleagues, nobody elected us. We are not representative of the people. We're not answerable to the people. We're perfectly suited for the job of interpreting the law, holding trials, deciding facts. That's what the judiciary is really good at. Writing laws to govern 330 million Americans across a continental nation, it's not what we were designed to do. You would never give that job. Who would design a constitution that gives that job to nine old, I can say that now, people sitting in Washington?
You're the youngest among them.
Well, nobody would write such a constitution, Margaret. Nobody. And the Constitution gives the power to write new laws to the people's representatives who are accountable to the people so that they can make those laws, change those laws, and compromise.
So how is the executive branch then? You write extensively about administrative law and the place where executive agencies find themselves in the position of writing rules and regulations that then individuals are accountable to, perhaps without any knowledge of those rules.
So you're saying what happens when we mix up the executive and the legislative function? Okay. Would you allow a king to write laws for you? Who would want that constitution? That might be even worse than nine old people, right? Having a single person who can write and change the laws anytime he or she wishes. That is what happens when the executive branch takes control. And it may even be worse than that, Margaret. Because what happens if the king is distracted? He's busy. So he hands off the job for writing these rules to a nice group of people, a bunch of wise old people, or maybe just bureaucrats. The administrative state. And what if they get to write rules? Well, without any of the constraints of the legislative process, bicameralism, two houses, presentment to the president for approval or a veto, without the requirements of compromise that come about in the legislative process. I mean, that's the beauty of the legislative process, is it allows for irrational compromises by people so that we can live with one another. All that goes out the window when the king or his bureaucrats and minions, his court, his followers, are allowed to make up whatever rule they want, whenever they want.
Well, and the good news is, at least our king is accountable to the people every 4 years. We don't have a king, fortunately. But what you write about in the context of administrative law is that many of those individuals who have been given the authority to write these rules and regulations are actually not held accountable to the people in the sense that, and who don't serve a term that is accountable to the people.
You can call them what you want. I think the nicest term I've heard is the administrative state. And what happens in administrative state, Madison knew exactly what would happen if you made lawmaking so easy. He said you're going to wind up with laws so voluminous no one can read them, so incomprehensible nobody can understand them.
And this has happened. This is the United States versus Carlos. You write about this in your book. A couple who had a company who were charged with violating rules on the books that didn't even exist at the time that they broke them.
Yeah, and that's exactly what happened in the case you're talking about. This is what made me such a passionate advocate of the separation of powers, was being a judge and seeing how it impacted real people in their lives. Small company in Colorado called Caring Hearts that took care of Medicare patients at home. They were accused of Medicare fraud, of misleading the government about their charges, and were fined $800,000. And you know, a small business accused of fraud by the government isn't likely to last long. Well, by the time we dug down, I mean, and it took us a while to dig down into this, we found out that they were charging this company, small company, with violating rules that did not yet exist. There are 37,000 Medicare rules. It's a telephone book. It's a new one published every year. And the government couldn't even keep track of the rules that it was issuing.
Justice Gorsuch, how does this happen? I mean, we have the separation of powers. We've agreed to the separation of powers. So how do we find ourselves in a circumstance where they're so muddled?
Well, I mean, responsibility can be found many places, and I'm not casting any stones. But one problem is that we have allowed Congress to pass the rulemaking, the lawmaking function to the executive. Another problem is that judges have assumed some of the lawmaking powers ourselves. And some of it is we've refused to police these lines as a judiciary and say, no, you can't allow the executive branch to write all the laws. Congress, you have to do that job.